Yes.
Good
Good
evening,
evening,
everyone.
everyone.
Welcome to another session by the Biotech Research Club. So today we have with us Professor Natia Mutalagu, who is a new member of the Department of Biotechnology. So Dr. Natia Mutalagu obtained her bachelor's degree from Madurai Kamaraj University in 2007 and went on to pursue a master's from the University of Madras. She commenced her PhD under the guidance of Professor Daniel Murphy at the University of Würzburg, Germany, before transferring to the University of Glasgow, UK to complete her studies in 2015. Later, she worked at the Beatson Institute for Cancer Research as a postdoctoral fellow until February 2020 before joining IIT Madras as a faculty member. As a PhD student and a postdoctoral fellow, Dr. Natia utilized various genetically engineered mouse models and cell culture models and characterized a new metastatic mouse model for the pancreatic cancer driven by oncogenes MYC and KRAS. The overarching goal of Dr. Natia's research is to understand at the molecular and cellular level how oncogenes control neuroendocrine plasticity and how this contributes to metastasis and how we can target this to improve the clinical outcome of patients. I kindly request everyone to turn off their videos and mute their mics for the duration of the talk unless you have a question. You can either unmute yourself to ask questions or put them in the chat box. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Neha. Thank you for the introduction. Hello, everybody. I'm just trying to present. Yeah. Okay, so feel free to interrupt me anytime you want, but since I cannot see the actual screen, you have to turn on the mic and ask the question, stop me and ask the questions, okay? So as you could see from the poster, I talk about some of the mouse models that I have used in cancer research, both during my PhD and also during my postdoctoral fellow. So Neha explained, you know, where I started. So I'm basically from Tamil Nadu, from it's a place called Karaikudi. And then, yeah, so I went to Germany and then from there moved to UK. But in both during my PhD and my postdoc, one of the things that was common in my research is oncogenic. So during my PhD, what I studied was how this particular oncogene drives cell death. And during my postdoctoral fellowship, I studied how oncogene MYC contribute to pancreatic tumorigenesis, how this cooperate with another oncogene called KRAS, okay?
I'm sorry to interrupt. Could you please make it full screen if possible?
Oh yeah, sorry. So the common theme of my research has always been oncogene MYC, which is the most frequently deregulated oncogene in human cancer. It's deregulated in almost 50% of the cancer. So it's either overexpressed or mutated so that the activity is high, or it is translocated into genes like IgG heavy chain so that there is a massive overexpression, or it's amplified. You know, there are multiple ways, but it's deregulated in one way or the other, or even the upstream pathway that regulates the expression of this particular protein is deregulated. For example, KRAS, which is part of the MAP kinase pathway, and one of the downstream effector for KRAS is MYC. And in pancreatic cancer, for example, KRAS is mutated in 95% of the cases. So you can see, you know, this particular protein or oncogene is really important for the cancer to survive. And also, it's in a normal physiological function also, it's very important because it regulates almost 15% of the human genome, meaning the target of the MYC is involved in variety of cellular processes like proliferation, you know, stem, maintaining stemness, or metabolism, even driving apoptosis. So MYC has a critical role, and one of the thing that my lab, not my current lab, my former lab found was that this level of MYC expressed is very, very important. There is a certain threshold of MYC that is required for driving proliferation or cell, you know, cell division, let's say. So when I say proliferation, what I mean is level of required for cell to divide and multiply, there is certain level, but above, if the MYC expression goes above this level, then it drives apoptosis or cell death. Okay, so there is this fine balance in terms of MYC expression. If the expression is low, it drives cell proliferation. If the expression is extremely high, then it drives apoptosis. So we could use mouse models to modulate MYC expression to different level. Like we can have mouse system where the MYC expression is similar to the endogenous MYC expression. We can also have a genetic system where MYC expression resembles something like in cancer settings, like something like in Burkitt lymphoma, where MYC expression is extremely high because it is translocated to the IgG heavy chains. Okay, so we could use mouse model as a tool to study different level of MYC and to understand what level of MYC drive which processes and how the system reacts to that particular level of MYC. So during my research time, I have used two different types of, I have used multiple type of genetic system, but two system that I have used most, where the first one is ubiquitous expression of MYC, meaning here, so I don't know if you have studied or if you came across transgenic mouse models. So what we do here is, if you have a particular gene of interest, if you want to overexpress it, if you want to delete it, we modify the genome of the mouse during the in the stem cell stage, like in the embryo, so that it can do either ubiquitous expression, like the whole body can express that particular gene, or we can combine it with different models to be tissue specific. So first one I'll explain is the ubiquitous model, which means this MYC is expressed in every single organ of the mouse. Okay, so it is expressed in every single cell of the mouse. So we chose this locus called ROSA26 locus, which is ubiquitous, meaning it is expressed all the time. It doesn't have any control. It is expressed all the time in every single cell of the mouse body. So we put this transgene MYC, but here we have this MYC as a fusion protein. MYC is together with something called estrogen receptor. So what happens is, this estrogen receptor is usually held in the cytoplasm. So MYC is a transcriptional factor, right? So it has to go to the nucleus. So although it is expressed everywhere in the mouse system, it's not active because it has to go to the nucleus, but this estrogen receptor holds MYC in the cytoplasm and gets degraded. What we can do is, we can decide when we want to activate it and give a ligand for this estrogen receptor, which is called tamoxifen. So once we give this ligand, it binds to the estrogen receptor, and then that makes the MYC go to the nucleus, that translocates to the nucleus, because that's how estrogen receptor works. Usually in a system, estrogen receptor is in the cytoplasm. Only when it binds to the ligand, it goes to the nucleus. So we use that as a control system here. Okay, so what happens is, if I decide, okay, I want when the mouse reaches age of 4 weeks, then I want to know at this time, if I activate MYC, what happens. So what I did was, usually we do 8 weeks because that's the adult age for the mice. So when the mice reaches 8 weeks age, we inject tamoxifen into its peritoneum, like into its belly, and it goes everywhere and activates this MYC. So what you can study is, you can do, okay, what happens when you activate MYC for 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, whether it drives proliferation or cell death. And again, we found that although this ROSA26 locus is ubiquitous, its expression changes from one tissue to the other. For example, in small intestine, its expression is really high, whereas in other tissues, its expression is low. So based on that, in other tissues, in this model, when we activate MYC, it drives proliferation, whereas in small intestine, where it is really high, it drives cell death. Okay, so using this model, what I have studied is how exactly this MYC drives cell death, which pathway is involved. So for that, what we did was we crossed this mice with a knockout mice of different genes. So whatever genes I think is involved in MYC-induced cell death, I used that and crossed this mice together with that mice. For example, there is a important protein in the apoptotic pathway called BIM. So we knocked that protein out in all the tissues and we crossed that with this mice. So what happens is, when we activate MYC, that protein won't be present. So if that protein is very important for MYC-induced cell death, then cell death won't happen. Okay, so that's how we found out that particular protein is important for cell death. Okay, so you can use this in combination with various other knockout models to study role of MYC in different cellular processes. I use only for cell death, but you can use it for any different processes. The second one that I used, so this is ubiquitous, right? But to study cancer, we cannot have this ubiquitous MYC, because then mice will get cancer everywhere, and then no single cancer will reach the end stage. You have to take the mice because it has so much load for cancer of tumor. So what we did was modify this model to make it tissue specific. Okay, so here we remove the ER moiety, so we just have MYC. It is under the ROSA 26 locus, but before the gene, we inserted something called LOX stop LOX locus. Okay, so what this is it has a stop codon, so there won't be any transcription happening, because even if it's transcribed, it will stop here, so MYC won't be expressed. So these mice, although it carries this gene, MYC is not expressed. So to make it tissue specific, you need to remove this stop codon only in specific tissue you are interested. Okay, so to remove the stop codon, you need Cre recombinase, which is an enzyme that recombines this LOXP sites, and thereby cutting this any part of the gene, any part of the DNA that is between these LOXP sites. So if you have a Cre recombinase expression, this stop codon will be removed, MYC will be expressed. So what you can do is you can make this Cre recombinase tissue specific. For example, if you want, we use this in various different models, like in lung. What we did, we just used a virus particle of Cre recombinase and then made the mouse inhale the virus. So once it inhales it, the virus reaches the lung, where it will recombine and MYC will be expressed. Okay. Similarly, I used it in the pancreatic cancer, where we have a Cre recombinase expressed under the pancreatic specific promoter. Okay. If you have studied molecular biology or cell biology, you might know that not every gene is expressed in every cell. There are some tissue-specific expression of certain genes, certain proteins. So we made use of that. So there will be a transcription factor that is expressed only in the pancreas. So we, under that promoter, under that transcription factor promoter, we put Cre recombinase gene. Okay. So in that tissue, there will be pancreatic-specific expression of Cre recombinase, which recombines this stop codon or delete the stop codon and make the MYC expression only in the pancreas. Okay, so I use this model to combine with other oncogene to study what is the role of MYC in pancreatic cancer. But I have also used this in intestinal model, where we use again intestinal specific tree. Okay. So why I study pancreatic cancer? I'm still interested in pancreatic cancer because it's the fourth leading cause of cancer-related death worldwide, and it's very, very deadly cancer. So if a patient is diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, only 5% of them live up to 5 years after diagnosis. So there is, it's very deadly, there is no treatment, and also there is no improvement in the survival. So here what you see is the various type of cancer and improvement in survival that we made in 3 decades from 70s to 2011. So you can see the testicular cancer, it we improved the survival from 75% to almost 100%. So we made progress in melanoma and various cancer, but you can see pancreas, it remains the same. Even after enormous research, the survival of the pancreatic patient, cancer patient, is really dismal. Okay, so in the pancreatic cancer, there are different subtypes, and one such subtype is a pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma, PDAC for short. So I'll say PDAC in the rest of the seminar. So in this PDAC, KRAS, another oncogene, as I said before, is mutated in majority of the cases, even 93% and above. But as I said, one of the key downstream regulator of KRAS is MYC, right? So although it is mutated in 93% of cancer, this is particular mutation that's very common, KRAS G12D, meaning the 12th amino acid is modified to from G to D. Okay? So although when we express this particular mutant in the pancreas, it didn't drive full-blown tumor. What it did was, there was only early lesion of pancreatic cancer that doesn't really progress into full-blown tumor. So although KRAS drives MYC expression, this is not enough to drive full-blown cancer. So what I asked is, So what I asked is, if we increase the expression of MYC in the system, whether we get full-blown cancer, okay? So for that, I use this mouse model where, as I said before, we have this MYC under the ROSA 26 locus, and we have this mutant KRAS. This particular codon is mutated, and endogenous normal KRAS is replaced with this mutant, okay? But this is again preceded by this stop cassette, and we have this Cre recombination under this PDX1 promoter, which is pancreatic specific promoter. So when we have the expression of Cre, what happens is the stop cassette is removed, and there will be expression of the mutant KRAS and MYC only in the pancreas. And this, I will refer this to as KMC in rest of the talk. Okay. So what I did is, I have cohorts of mice with, for example, mouse just which express only KRAS, mouse which express only MYC, or mouse which express both combination of MYC and KRAS. And we will watch them for any symptoms of pancreatic cancer. There are certain symptoms of pancreatic cancer that if you touch the abdomen, it will be hard, it will be really looking sick. So we have certain symptoms. Once they reach the symptom, then we will take the mice, we'll kill the mice, and then analyze the pancreatic tumor. And then we design something called survival curve. So here you will see a lot of this in the rest of the presentation. So I'll take some time to explain you this. So here this red represents mice that carries both KRAS and MYC. Okay. And this is the age of the mice. And each drop represents a mouse dying of pancreatic cancer. Okay, so when a mouse dies, we record the time it lived. For example, this mouse here lived only about 50 days, whereas this mouse lived about 100 days. Okay, and you can see in orange, the mouse that has KRAS on average lived from 120 to even 450 days. The mice that carries MYC on its own live from about 200 to 400 days. But if you combine both KRAS and MYC, you can see that survival is reduced so much, and the median survival is about 50 days. Okay. So this is a first indication that if you put KRAS and MYC together, it accelerates the disease, which is nothing surprising, right? If you have two oncogenes and if you put together, obviously it's going to drive cancer faster. But what we are interested in is how MYC contributes, what is the process that is involved in this progression, okay? So for to get some idea, what I did is I took the pancreatic tumor from the mice that express only KRAS and tumor from the mice that express both KRAS and MYC, and did something called RNA sequencing. RNA sequencing is a method where which we can use to study differences in expression between two settings. Here I chose KC and KMC mice tumor and did RNA sequencing, and then we can analyze the data to know which pathway is the most significantly related between the cohort, meaning compared to the KRAS mice, what are the pathways that were upregulated or downregulated? Okay, so here I'm showing only downregulated pathway because you can see, I don't know if you can read, but majority, like 10 out of 15 top downregulated pathway in the KMC mice were immune related. Okay, so meaning is if you have high MYC, so we have, if you compare the expression of MYC, when compared to KC mice, like KRAS mice, KMC mice will have high MYC expression, okay? If you have high MYC expression, immune pathways are downregulated, okay? Less expression of immune pathways. So, if the immune pathways were downregulated, we wanted to know if immune infiltration in these tumors are different. So we checked various different immune cells. Two immune cell type that was showing difference is NK cells, which is nothing, which is called natural killer cells, and B cells. These are the cells that makes antibodies. Okay, so this is another technique called immunohistochemistry. What you can do is when you take the tumor out, you can fix the tumor and then cut into thin sections and use antibody to stain for various different markers you are interested in. So here we are staining for NKp46, which is a receptor which is only present in NK cells. Here we are staining for CD45R, which is again a receptor present only in B cells. So this is quantified here, okay? So each dot represents number of NK cells present in per millimeter square of the tumor. So you can see clear drop in number of NK cells and drop in number of B cells that are recruited into the KMC tumors, okay? So if you think about tumor, it's just not about epithelial cells or tumor cells. It has huge range of other cells like immune cells, fibroblasts, which all help in tumor growth. Sometimes immune cells are good, like T cells are really good for our body because it helps to fight the tumor. Whereas some immune cells are bad, meaning it helps the tumor rather than the body, okay? So we don't know in which category these two immune cells are in, but these KMC mice have less of these and they live less time compared to the KC mice. So the assumption is these two cells must be good immune cells helping the body, because when there is less of these tumor grow bigger, okay? So what next we asked is, okay, what is the time? Okay, not bad. So what we asked is, how important is MYC-mediated suppression? Meaning all these pathways were downregulated, right? So there are transcription factors which can activate gene, and there are transcriptional factors which can reduce the expression of genes. MYC is a transcriptional factor which can both activate and repress genes depending on which partner protein it binds, okay? So one of the partner protein that helps to repress transcription is called MIS1. So what we asked is, if for the repression that we see, if this particular protein is important, okay? So we crossed this mice, which carries all these things, KMC, with misfloxed mice, meaning this MIS1 gene, we put the LOXP site kind of planking the MIS1 gene. So when there is a Cre recombinase expression, there will be activation of KRAS, there will be expression of MYC, and here there will be loss of MIS1, okay? So in the KMC setting, if MIS1 is lost, what happens? If MIS1 is lost, then number of NK cells and number of B cells now increases, okay, compared to KMC, meaning MIS1 is important in repressing infiltration of these two cells. So if these both cells are important for the survival, then when they are more in this particular genotype, then this particular genotype should live longer, right? Because they should help in fighting the disease. And that's exactly what happens. So here is the survival of KMC mice in black. And you can see when you delete MIS1, they live significantly longer, meaning the immune infiltration we see have a helps to fight the cancer in this particular genotype. So what is the link between this MYC and MIS and immune infiltration? We know that pathways are repressed, but what exactly is the linking factor? So since it is about infiltration, we looked for any chemokine or cytokine that is different, because these are the molecules that help immune cells to come to the tumor site. So one of the chemokine that is very different is CXCL13. Okay, this is very important factor, chemokine that helps in recruiting B cell into any site, any infection site or any tumor. It is also shown to be recruited in it's also shown to be important in recruitment of NK cells. But one of the things that was striking is that the CXCL13 doesn't come from tumor cells. It comes from another immune cell called macrophages. The reason I say that is, this is the expression of CXCL13. You can see in KMC mice there is nothing, whereas when there is a Mrs. Phlox, you can see massive expression. But if you stain for macrophages, these areas are occupied by macrophages. Okay, it's not occupied by tumor cells, but they are occupied by macrophages. So just to summarize what I have found out is, if you have tumor cells and it has RAS and MYC expressed, what happens is, I'm not showing you those data, what happens is MYC together with MIS1 represses something called interferon regulatory factors, which is important for recruiting, activating macrophages to secrete CXCL13, which is a chemokine, which helps in bringing NK cells and B cells into the tumor to fight the tumor. Okay, so when you lose MIS1, this repression is lost. So there is now excess interferon leading to activation of macrophages, leading to expression of CXCL13 and more B cell and NK cells. Some of these things we proved by following experiments. So what, this is all not important. So as I said, when you do not have a MIS1, you have a more interferon, which activates macrophages to produce CXCL13, which kind of helps be an NK cell infiltration, and it has anti-tumor effect. So what we did, if we block this pathway here, then nothing should happen. Then whatever the anti-tumor effect should be lost, then mice should not live longer, okay? So the idea is to reduce to know if this is the actual pathway. So what we did, we took the MIS1, KMC MIS1 mice, and block the receptor with antibody. What you can do is, for the receptor to work, the receptor needs to be open for the ligand. What we can do is we can use the antibody against this receptor, inject into the mouse peritoneum again. So what this antibody does, it goes and block the receptor, so the ligand cannot act. Although there will be more interferon, there won't be any receptor to act to activate the macrophages. Okay. So what happens when you use this IFNAR antibody? The B cell number drops, NK cell number drops, and the mice don't live longer anymore. So this is the KMC MIS1. You can see when you block with IFNAR, the survival reduces. And if you compare this to KMC, it kind of reverts back to the KMC mice. Okay. Similarly, we blocked one step down. Here we used CXCL13 antibody. Again, the result is the same. Even if you block here, if you block the NK cell with the NK cell blocking antibody, so what this does is it blocks the NK cell so that NK cell cannot do its cytotoxic work. So even then, there is reduction in survival. Okay, although both B and NK cell are activated, NK cell blocking NK cell alone seems to reduce the survival effect. So at this moment, we do not know whether B cell is a bystander or it is, if it does have any separate role or not. Okay. So what I have shown is MYC accelerates KRAS induced PDAC, and these tumors have less infiltration of B and NK cells, and deletion of this particular transcriptional factor called MIS1 restores this B and NK cells, which results in increasing in survival. And targeting interferon signaling negates the survival benefit of MIS1 deletion. Okay, so if you target interferon signaling or CXCL13 or NK cell itself, whatever increase in survival we saw because of deletion of MIS1 kind of reverts back. Okay, so just quickly, what I am interested in my current lab, one of the things that I did not show is when we have KRAS and MYC together, it drives this tumor called PDAC. But when we have MYC on its own, it drives completely different type of pancreatic tumor called neuroendocrine tumor. So you can see from the picture itself, they look very different, right? It has a different histology, okay? This is called histology, which is nothing but using some stains to look at the morphology of the any given tissue, okay? So what I'm interested in is why MYC is driving one tumor in when on its own, but it drives completely different tumor when you combine this with KRAS. And also we have I kind of improved this model here. Previously we have PDX1 Cre, right, which means that Cre recombinase is expressed already when the mouse embryo is 8 days old. So the KRAS and MYC will be expressed when they're already in the embryo stage. But now we change this Cre to again Cre-ER, so we can activate whenever we need it. So we can let the mice reach the adult stage and then give tamoxifen, so that MYC and KRAS is expressed only after, only during the adult stage. So during this, what we found is I combine this with a fluorescent protein called IRFP, and you can use a fluorescent imager to image all the tumor. If you can see this dot, this is the diaphragm, this is liver, and you can see various dots. So this pancreatic tumor metastasized to liver and diaphragm in the mouse, which is the common site. And again, these, the histology of these two looks very different. Liver tumor looks more like a neuroendocrine tumor, whereas diaphragm tumor looks more like a PDAC. So I'm also interested in what are these differences in these two sides, which makes these tumors look very different. Okay, so that's it. If you guys have any questions regarding the research or regarding how I came to IIT or why I came to IIT, or any other, feel free to ask. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yes, you can go ahead with questions. Almost.
Yeah, I have a question. How do you block NK cells?
So we used NK1.1 antibody. So the NK1.1 is a receptor that NK cells has. So we use an antibody against this receptor. So what happens is NK cell cannot function. Sometimes NK, not sometimes, when you use this antibody, NK cell gets depleted, meaning it undergoes cell death, because it's blocked, and that results in an antibody-mediated cell death. So there won't be any NK cells left in the mouse system.
Thank you.
So we can check this with facts. So once we inject this NK1.1 antibody, what I do is I take blood and then check how many NK cells are present before injecting this antibody and after injecting this antibody. So we verify each time that NK cell is actually blocked or deleted, depleted.
Okay. I have another question that might be a little dumb, but when you, in the KMC model, you're overexpressing both MYC and RAS, and you also had another model where you overexpress only MYC.
Mm-hmm.
You mentioned, like, at the beginning of your talk that when MYC is extremely high, it leads to apoptosis.
Yeah.
How do you, like, control the levels? How do you ensure that the MYC levels don't go?
So you can control the level based on the promoter you use. So here we use ROSA 26 locus, which is kind of ubiquitous. It just physiologically, that ROSA 26 locus expression is high in small intestine and low in pancreas. We didn't do anything. It was an accident. Okay. That's how we found that a high level of MYC is causing cell death. But you can also use different promoter. For example, if you use insulin promoter in a normal physiological, during normal physiology of the mouse pancreas, insulin will be secreted high. So if you put MYC under the insulin promoter, then MYC expression will be high also. So you can use the particular promoter to change the level of MYC expressed.
Okay. So the mechanism by which it causes cell death is not known.
That's what my PhD work is on. So where what I used different knockout models and found out that mitochondrial pathway of apoptosis and BIM protein in particular, because MYC is a transcriptional factor and then it drives expression of BIM, which is causing cell death.
Okay. But it's only at high concentration. So
yes,
I mean,
only at high. Mm-hmm. Otherwise it drives proliferation only.
Okay, how does that happen? Like, is there some particular gene regulatory network that ensures that it happens only at high concentrations?
Yes. Because in a normal physiological condition, MYC is important in driving proliferation only, like stemness and proliferation. Mm-hmm. So I think it is kind of inbuilt mechanism to avoid cancer settings. So when some cancer cells have if one cell is kind of affected and it has high level of MYC, it gets cleared by cell death. When it escapes, there is also various other escape mechanism. It can mutate another gene so that it doesn't undergo cell death, you know. So all these things happen during cancer progression. But I think it's kind of an inbuilt mechanism to avoid any cancerous growth. I think in our body, every day some cell gets mutated, but not everybody gets cancer, but it become cancerous because it's always cleared. Only those unfortunate cells which don't get cleared away becomes cancer.
Okay, thank you.
Ma'am, I have just one question.
Mm-hmm.
You have shown, like, when we reduce the function of natural killer cells by removing them from the system, survival goes down. So if we try to enhance their function, it can again go back to the state, or
Yeah, that's a very good question. So that would be the actual therapeutic option, right? Because the whatever I did is to try and prove the mechanistic point of view. But to help the cancer patient, we have to increase the survival, right? So one of the option would be to actually activate interferon so that the survival will be improved. And different, we didn't do that, but different group did that experiment. They, what they gave is, they gave interferon as a, so you can, as a recombinant protein, and they have found that there is an increase in survival in the mouse. Yeah, that's a good question. That's one of the therapeutic avenue that people can explore from this study.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Initially you said this period.
I cannot hear you, Nanda Kumar.
Yes. Am I audible now?
Yes.
So initially you said the PDACs are quite have a very poor prognosis, right? So is immune evasion one of the main reasons why they have a very poor prognosis?
No, it's mainly because you don't get symptoms until very last minute. You can survive with very little pancreatic function. So, and also the location of the pancreas is kind of behind the stomach. So, even during routine scan for other, it's not really visible. So, I think diagnosis is the main problem. I think if we increase the diagnosis or if we find some biomarkers, for example, that will help us improving the survival. Because most of the time we diagnose the patient with advanced disease with really high metastatic burden, at which stage, you know, therapy is not an option. Most of the time it's only, you know, palliative care, just to keep them painless until they, you know, they die. So it's really diagnosis that's the problem.
So immune evasion has very little to do with the prognosis.
Immune evasion has a lot to do with progression, but that is not the main reason for the dismal survival. The main reason is we are detecting at very late stage. And immune evasion helps the pancreatic tumor to go to late stage for sure. But because we are treating really full-blown tumor, then the treatment, whatever we have at that moment, at the moment it's only chemotherapy, not even much of targeted therapy, then the body don't really respond. The tumor don't respond, then the patients don't have enough energy to kind of handle those chemotherapy even. So immune evasion have a major role in terms of progression, but I think main problem is the diagnosis, which immune evasion do not have much role to play.
One more question, ma'am. So in your presentation, you said the relation between MYC and MIR. I think it's MIR. I'm sorry, I forgot the name. MYC and one.
MYC and what? Sorry, MIS-1. Okay.
MIS-1. Yeah, MIZ. So what's the relation, like mechanistic relation? They have some kind of counteractions.
Yeah. So MYC is a transcriptional factor which binds with partner proteins, various different partner proteins before it binds to the DNA. So one such partner protein is MAX. If it binds to MAX, it activates the transcription by recruiting various chromatin modifying factors and activates transcription. But if MYC and MAX together binds MIS-1, then it represses the gene that MIS-1 usually activates. Okay, so MIS-1 is also a transcription factor. So these are all transcription factor. Depending on which factor it binds, it either activates the gene or represses the gene. Okay, so it has a motif, common element in the DNA which these recognizes, and all those things.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Good evening, ma'am. I have a small question.
Good evening. Yeah.
So while creating this transgenic mice models, for tissue specific expression, so we use a tissue specific promoter. For example, in this use PDX1. Is there any database to choose a particular promoter in a particular model, type of model?
So
how do we make a difference?
All the tissue-specific promoters are available. All the tissue-specific trees are available. You do not have to reinvent the wheel. If you name a tissue, there will be somebody who would have used it. And most of the time, we have something called mouse repository, where all the researchers are encouraged to deposit their mice there. So it's available there for everybody to use. So you just have to pay some fees and then you can even import to India. So it's all available. But if you ask me, hypothetically, if you do not know, then there will be expression data available between different tissues. You can just compare and then find out, if you can find a tissue specific expression of certain protein or a transcription factor. To make a new line. But this is all kind of elucidated already from a developmental biology point of view as well. We know already what transcriptional factor expression kind of determine the fate of a particular cell to become a pancreas, to become a muscle, to become all these things are already characterized. So we are lucky to live now because most of these things we know, so that our job is a little easier.
Hello, ma'am. Good evening.
Hi.
Ma'am, I have an education, like small person. So you used tamoxifen. So is there any alternative for tamoxifen, like you can use in that case?
Not that I know of. We have only used tamoxifen. And it's cheap also. So, but yes, it's a COSH3 chemical, which means it's cancer. It has a cancer promoting property, so you have to use it a bit more carefully. On top of my head, I cannot think of anything that you can use. I have never used it. I have used the tamoxifen for almost like 12 years, and I have used only tamoxifen. In cell culture, you use something called 4-hydroxytamoxifen, which is just modified form. But other than that, I don't know. Any ligand for the distribution.